What we like to do is across the fence comparison. And we have a study going on kind of called dynamic soil property study. And dynamic soil properties are those properties that change with management. Static soil properties, you can't change them really no matter what you do to them, but the dynamic soil properties will change. So just as you saw differences in management on the cropland and how they reacted with infiltration versus runoff, the same kind of thing happens on rangeland. So we look at sites across the fence that are the same soil. In this case, it's an opal soil. That would be a clay ecological site. Is that right, Nathan? Is Nathan still around? Anyway, might be heavier than that. Okay, but it's in that ballpark. And so it's the same ecological site regardless. And so we compare infiltration on both sides of the fence, and then we look at other soil properties, and we're going to show you a few of those here in a minute. Infiltration doesn't necessarily measure any specific thing, any one thing. It's kind of a conglomeration of all the other properties, and it gives you a gauge of how all those other properties are working. That can be your soil structure, the mycorrhizal fungi, the bacteria, all the things that go together to form that soil ecosystem. That's kind of what infiltration is showing, is how they're all working together. So you can't say any one thing about how an infiltration test comes out other than that the soil is functioning well from a hydrologic standpoint. So that's why we do it. It's shown in our dynamic soil property studies to be a very, very good test. It's very sensitive to changes in management. So Jeff, why don't we, anything else you want to add there?
I just wanted to describe the community a little bit more.
Okay, so on this side of the fence, this has been rested for a while, Dwayne, I assume. And we've got a pretty good diverse plant community in here, western wheatgrass, green needle grass. Those are, on a clay site, those are the two dominant grasses that you want to see. And so that's showing us that it's in pretty good condition. On the other side of the fence, where we've had probably season-long grazing over quite a long period of time, when we walk up closer to the fence, take a look at it, but it's there's a lot of buffalo grass in there, blue grama. There's still western wheatgrass, but it's diminished quite a bit. So the short grasses have moved in and have replaced the taller green needle grass and western wheat.
So when we bought this, it was mostly cheatgrass and bluegrass.
Okay. So it's really come back through their management. Here's some of your green needle grass right here. These long green leaves like that. It's a bunch grass. Western wheatgrass is rhizomatous. It's the blue-green stuff all throughout here. And there's some Kentucky bluegrass and some other things in here as well. Anything else you want to mention? Why don't we go ahead?
Mostly just a little bit of suppression and rest. We'd like to have done more grazing, but we just didn't do that.
Any kind of disturbance can kind of throw off that soil ecosystem. And long-term rest is a kind of disturbance as well. Or removing livestock from a system is a type of disturbance in a way. So the right amount of livestock grazing is what these sites formed with, and that's what they're used to. So that's where you want to be. So why don't we go ahead and run a infiltration test. You can try to come in a little closer if you want. We're going to go ahead and... So as Jeff mentioned, we've got these infiltration rings back at the shop down there. If you want to do some of this on your own, basically what you do is clip off an area down to the ground so you can get the cellophane down. Jeff's going to do all the work for me here. It's like sitting in the passenger seat, you know. Versus driving the car, so you don't have to open the gates. Now we're kind of at the tail end, definitely at the tail end of when you'd want to be doing an infiltration test on your rangeland. The biological activity is starting to taper off this time of year, and the soils, especially clay soils, start to crack, and you'll see that on the other side of the fence even more, where it's more exposed. So that's soil cracks kind of throw off in a test like this. So basically, after you drive the ring down into your about the second knuckle on your finger, about 2 inches showing, you put the cellophane in there, and I can time it for you if you want. Okay, well, whatever. And you put the water in. You put the cellophane down so you can start the water and the timer at the same time is basically what you do.
Did you tell me you put 444 milliliters?
Thank you, yeah, 444 milliliters. In the infiltration kit, there's a cup that measures it out for you. And then once you got it in there.
Just say go, Stan.
Go.
Ready?
And the reason 444 equals 1 acre inch, there's 27,154 gallons in an acre inch. Everybody should memorize it by the end of the day.
There's a test later.
That's a test. 27,154. Huh? So that's why we do 444 and we adjust it for that 6-inch ring.
I would say it's done, but you
get just a little bit over there and
he's a splitter here.
Okay.
Lumper slip.
All right, 35 seconds. That was the first inch.
And yesterday we did. We put another ring in over here. It was 43 seconds. So it's really very similar to the.
Did you want to try a second inch on that one? Or?
And let's do that.
Well, you have to do this. Probably correctly doing it.
If you read the instructions, which some people I know are bad about that, but
it's really the second inch we're interested in.
What's that?
We're really interested in the second inch.
Yeah, the second inch is really kind of what we gauge. We
you
do our measurements
on. This one?
Yesterday, that's when I was out here.
Good for you.
Remember we talked about that last
night.
Mm-hmm. Why I was so late.
Well,
I was here.
By the way, this is not exactly rehearsed, but we've done this a lot. But
and we put the wrap, the plastic wrap on top, so that you can pull it so you don't instantaneously push the water all and disrupt it. So you want to do is gradually and then just pull the plastic away.
Okay, Stan, you ready again?
Okay, go. And we typically, you expect the second inch to take a little longer than the first inch. But that's more of an even test because then you've wetted the soil, pre-wetted the soil, and that gives you a better comparison on your samples and whatnot.
Then, you can download a soil quality kit manual for free on NRCS. And on page 62, it tells you the infiltration rate is. So what was the reading that you got last time?
35 seconds.
35 seconds. So it's it's more than 20 inches per hour on this site. That's what it's telling you. Okay. So if it's less than 3 minutes per inch, if it's less than 3 minutes, you're talking about an infiltration rate of 20, 40, that's what, so you can get this manual and you can get it on free for online.
Okay, the second inch here was 40 seconds.
Very similar to the first, yeah.
You wanna go ahead and run this other one?
Sure,
so we'll
do that.
So fresh in our mind. You don't have to come over the fence, but you can come up to it if you want. Jeff is gonna run the second inch over here.
I'm gonna go on the other side of the fence. I might challenge you guys watch
this. Oh yeah, I think he's already got it.
What about the plant community above ground? What do you see here compared to the other side? The plant community or the soil surface? What kinds of things do you see? Shout it out. Don't be shy. Yeah, it is. It's grazed. If you look around, especially I know. Right up by the fence over there, there's pretty big patches of buffalo grass, that short little hairy grass. There's more bare ground and more trampling going on, which trampling in and of itself is not a bad thing. It's like everything, I guess, else in moderation. So we probably have some compaction going on.
Change.
Yeah.
How much time right there, Jeff?
I've got it here, I guess.
You got it. What's how much time?
That's a minute 45 right now.
It's a minute and 45.
And you can see these seed heads over here. This is blue grama. right here. So there's a pretty large component of our short grasses on this side of the fence, and that's through season-long grazing. The plant community has shifted from being dominated by western wheatgrass and green needlegrass, shifting to those shorter grasses. And numerous studies over the years have shown that that's negative on hydrology when you shift to a short grass community. And that's just through management over time. We're gonna look here in a minute. We might have to just come back and catch this. We'll check out some soil profiles here.
Did we bring a shovel?
He's got the shovel over there. Okay. So we'll come back to this. It's gonna be a little while. I'll just leave this here. Sorry to make you keep moving there.
Well, it might make a difference. It's grazed with horses, which is a little different than cattle, too.
Yeah, if you didn't hear, Dwayne, this pasture is grazed with horses. And so that they graze a little bit differently than cattle.
3 minutes for that one to go in.
Thank you. Jeff said it's going to be 20 to 30 minutes, so we have some time here. We're not going to wait. So, Jeff, do you want to... Let's take a look at these. So... One of the things I mentioned was one of the components that makes up that soil ecosystem, or some of the components, are your biological, your mycorrhizal fungi, the bacteria, nematodes, some of the insects that somebody mentioned. And then I'm right in the sun, aren't I? So then some of the other characteristics of soils that influence infiltration are the soil structure and organic matter. We're going to look at a couple of those right now. So. Here, which profile do you want me to?
It doesn't really matter which one you want to start on. You want to start on this one?
That's fine. Okay. So, is this one here?
Yep.
All right. Maybe you should.
You can actually see that what we're looking at here is that, and we'll break it up a little bit. So you can see that there's granular soil structure down to about 3 inches. At least that's what I'm seeing. And you're going to have to come closer to actually see that. But then we actually start getting into prismatic structure. And the interesting thing is, of course, these are right across the fence from each other, and the cool thing for me is, as a soils guy, is really starting to look at those differences in soil structure. Now, I talked about that before, but here I've got granular structure down. You want to move out of
this? Yeah, I'm in the sun.
You've got granular structure down here about 3 inches, and you can actually see that within that profile. But you know, we go right across the fence, and all of a sudden it's gone. That granular structure is gone. I have a subangular blocky structure in the very surface, and that prismatic structure carries right to the soil surface very quickly. So that breakdown in that soil structure because of that differences in management is really apparent in that profile, and very apparent when we actually start doing what? Some of those analysis. We start looking at bulk density. We start talking about macropore development. The test that we actually just ran here today, this infiltration, is very indicative what is that biological activity in that soil surface. That plant community, that interaction makes a huge difference in what we're visually seeing and the hydrology and the reaction that we actually have. And to me, it's like I say, from a soil standpoint, we look at that profile, look at that soil structure, and you go, wow, that's just a huge difference. Unbelievable difference in just over the fence comparisons. So from my standpoint, from a soil standpoint, you come out here and you look at this and go, just, you know, that there's phenomenal differences associated with management and that plant community within that visual of the profile. The interesting, like I say, getting back to to me, it's exciting that we start talking about that biological community. We can't really see most of that biological community, but we can see the effects on that structure. We can see that effects on some simple analysis that we can run out in the field. So I think that we can start to get a better handle on that and really start to compare systems in the field very quickly from one to the next.
That's an excellent point. People say, well, what test should I run to check on the biological activity? And what we found, the most consistent things that we found in these dynamic soil property studies are really the field measurements that we're doing right here, looking at structure, organic matter, and as you can tell from the color of the soils, and also infiltration. So these field measurements are some of the most indicative tests, really, and you don't have to send off to a lab for expensive tests. Those just haven't been quite as consistent for us as just the stuff you can see in the field. What about the color there in the different profiles.
You can really see that radical difference between those two profiles. I mean, you can stand over here and look in the sun, and you can see that those differences. You can see the browns, especially with associated with that larger amount of organic matter within that soil profile up at the front. You don't see that back here, and in fact, you can see that graying or glaying is very, very indicative of that subsoil material, and that carries on to that soil surface as we have this overgrazed condition. Like I say, as we really start looking at some of these differences over long-term management, to me, it's just phenomenal on those changes within that grass community that we actually see based on how we manage that plant community. So. Have you depleted that organic matter resource? Yes. Is it as productive as it could be? No. You can visually see that in that profile. I think it's really something to take home, and we get to do this. I get to do this all the time, and I find this is the most interesting part of my job is we get to do that across the fence comparisons. I think producers can do that from one field to the next. You need to start really paying attention to what that soil structure looks like, what that soil biology looks like, the macro pores, starting to look at some basic analysis so that you can come up with better systems and change your management for the better.
You think about how much more water was in the jars in the front compared to the back down there. And if we had some grassland samples, which we had back there, we didn't run them, you would see the same difference between the heavy continuous season long grazing versus rotational grazing and better plant community diversity. Just a stark difference. The runoff jar on the overgrazed stuff will be full, and the infiltration jar will be empty, and vice versa on the well-managed. But you think every inch of water that runs off of a piece of rangeland is somewhere in the neighborhood of 150 to 200 inches, 200 pounds per acre of production. So for every inch you lose, you're basically sending a couple hundred pounds of production down the hill to the neighbor or somewhere else, or not on your place anyway. So the idea with managing for granular soil structure and managing for organic matter and the things that make for better infiltration, that's money in your pocket, really, because that's more production on your place and it's not going somewhere else. Anything else?
I want to tie a point on here.
Okay, folks, we're going to do a little activity. Now, everybody, I want everybody to get on their knees. I mean, seriously, just get on their knees. I'm going to show you something. Because I want you to see when we go to the no-till fields, in the crop fields, you're going to see these spheres present. Every ecosystem throughout the world that has plants, you're going to see this sphere present. I want you to start identifying. I'm going to show you the five spheres that we should have it in our range ground. You should have it in your cropping, and you should have it on your no-till fields, and you should have them on your pasture. Okay? They're all connected. Now, once you come in here, help me. I'm going to show you. You guys all stay ready. I'm going to show you how to look at it. Okay. Can I use one of these?
Sure.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Okay. Everybody get ready. So everybody's going to dig around. Now, every one of you, part the grass and dig right until you get it to that. What do range people call this little, they call it a duff layer, right?
Yep.
What else do you call it? Thatch?
Litter.
That is called the detritus sphere. Soil ecologists call it the detritus sphere. Every ecosystem, a good healthy soil ecosystem should have it present. You will have it in a good no-till. It should be covered with that on a no-till. That is the skin of the soil. It is precious. It regulates temperature. You have these little mesofauna, these organisms breaking it down. It has to be present. Is it present, bam, in an organic field? No. Why is it not present in an organic field?
Tillage.
They bury it. Conventional, it will be buried. It will not be there. Indicator of way too much disturbance. This thing will help regulate the soil temperature. It is rain impact. Regulate soil temperature. That is called the detritus sphere. So the first thing when I do, I get a shovel full, I want to see that present. If it's not present, I know you're tilling too much. Too much inversion, it's not there. You will find it in pastures. You will find it present. Now, this beautiful layer that we were talking about, you know what this is called? The agratosphere. Scientists call it the agratosphere. I call it cottage cheese. I want to see cottage cheese. If I do not see cottage cheese in a no-till field, it's telling me one thing. You know what it's telling me? You're not feeding it enough. Not enough carbon. It takes huge amounts of liquid carbon to feed that. That is converted sun. I'm not doing enough covers. I'm taking too much carbon from the system. These aggregates only last 27 days, folks, in natural agro ecosystem. 27 days. That means they are feeding on that house. So you leave that ground fallow, what do you expect? Are we gonna have a lot of cottage cheese?
No.
We're not. We gotta remember the plant and soil are one. I think one of the biggest disfavors we ever did in our agriculture schools is to separate the plant and the soil. Class, if I take the plant out, and if I take the microbes out, what do I have, Dale? You got geology. You got geology. So, it's the biology and the plants that formulate this aggregation. They change the system. So I want to see lots of aggregation. Scott, do you think we'll see aggregation in a very heavily organic farm? No, you won't see a lot of aggregation, but you may see a lot of humic collars because they're hauling in carbon like crazy to offset the damage. Am I opposed to organic farmers? No, I'm not. Please don't misunderstand me. I'm telling you how to look at your soil when you walk in there. So we got an aggregate. So what's inside the aggregate, class? What's the other sphere? The porosphere, where air and water, what Jeff was talking about. So I want to see the rhizosphere, the detritosphere, that I want to see that. And I want to see aggregates. If I have aggregates, I have megapores, macropores, and then micropores. Tillage cannot destroy the micropore because the microbes cannot get into there and eat the polysaccharides, the organo-mineral complexes, the cementing agents created by biology and plants, okay? So, we got residue on the top. I wanna see that in all my agro-ecosystems. I wanna see it in my pasture. Now, what happens if this layer starts building up, the detritosphere builds up a lot, and it does not disappear? What is that telling you?
Like I've never seen.
You got it. It's not cycling properly. Your residue should not be celebrating its fifth birthday. It should not be there for 5 years. So that tells you that cycling. So we got to see residue. I want to see cottage cheese. Inside the cottage cheese, I got pores. Then rhizosphere. What's the rhizosphere, class? It's the roots. We gotta have living roots 24/7. Our job in all of our systems, living roots 24/7. It is the conduit that turns that sun into chemical energy. If you're not doing that, it is costing you big time in your operation. No roots, no aggregates. No aggregates, none of the biology is gonna be there. Okay, everybody with us. So how do we mismanage this? This right here, the tool, huh? And guess what's the first thing we blame? It's the cow. It's not the cow. It's us who have the lack of understanding and don't understand the ecology and how everything's connected. One more sphere, and we'll switch it over. Because what I want you to do, when we go to Dwayne's place and we look at the cropping, I want us to get out of the pickup, I mean, get out of there, and we're all gonna look for all those spheres. The drillosphere. That is Greek for worm. In every one of those passages, that slime on that body, it is critical. It is rich in phosphorus. It is rich in bacteria. It is a phenomenal thing to have in your soil ecosystem. Now, some are complaining that they're getting into wooded areas and changing the pH of the wooded areas because those earthworms have the ability to actually eat all the residue on top of the surface, and they're changing it. Now, when I go to a good agro ecosystem down in Duane, I want to see 4 earthworms per shovelful. That's equivalent to 850 to 1.5 million earthworms per acre. And you want to do it in the early spring because they move. I want to see 4 earthworms. And if you want to get really technical, like my buddy here, Jeff, you like the splitter, you get a 12 by 12 by 12. You want to see 20 earthworms. I want to see 20 earthworms on a foot by foot by foot. That's 850 to 1.5 million earthworms, which are cycling nutrients and moving the soil. They are the plow we want. We want them. They change the soil. I'll leave you with this last thought. Folks, there's a lot of debate now in the ecological communities. And if you get into this website called the Niche Construction, where they're saying, you know what, Darwin didn't always have it right. We used to think if we put organisms, they would adapt to the environment. We're saying now, no, they change the environment. Earthworms, you see these dark colors? Did not happen by themselves. It happened by the biology and the plants. They modify. Beavers modify the environment. You guys modify your environment. So we got to remember the biology and how powerful the biology is. So when we go out in the field, in the cropland, I want you to see if all these spheres are present. Ryan, which one's the cottage cheese? What is it called? A gratisphere. Okay, you don't have to remember all that, but remember, I want cottage cheese, residue, I want pores, I want to see earthworms, and I want to see roots. Okay, guys? Here you go.
Some point, I think we need to get back to the rest of the tour. So let's head on back.